I embrace my sickle cell disease, but I don't really let it define me as of what I can do and what I am capable of. On the outside, I look fine and I look normal, but on the inside, I'm not. Most people don't know what it is or understand.
Sickle cell is very hard to put into words what it actually feels like. Those words really do not exist.
Sickle cell can be alienating. It's a condition that forces me to re-examine everything about my life and how I accomplish those things.
I was hospitalized like once every 2 weeks. I'd already had my hips replaced. I had been in liver failure. I felt like there was no way that I could keep surviving with sickle cell and be happy. That's how I was feeling at 19.
Sickle cell is excruciating. Sickle cell is life-threatening. Sickle cell is strength when it's perceived as weakness.
In middle school, I did a science project and I looked up sickle cell and I found the life expectancy was 42 years old. When I saw that stat, my stomach dropped. You come across a lot of information that it's heavy information. To stay sane, you kind of have to just put it off to the side and you say, that's not for me, that's not my statistic, and just keep living your life. Within the sickle cell community, a lot of us are left to navigate this complex genetic disorder. And that's really hard.
Imagine your doctor discovering that you have a life-threatening disease, but then telling you that there's no reason to panic because they can fix it simply by editing it out of your genes and DNA.
Are you daring to say there's a cure for sickle cell anemia?
You know, sickle cell in the mainstream is huge. It's big for us.
New treatment for sickle cell anemia uses the power of gene editing.
The evolution of gene therapy has always included consideration of sickle cell because it's a fairly simple monogenic disorder.
Red blood cells are like a disc, almost like a frisbee, if you will. And in sickle cell disease, what happens is the hemoglobin molecules inside that cell snap together like Legos. And when they do that, they can change the shape of that cell from a frisbee to a more sickle form, a banana shape or curved shape, which is what the disease gets its name from, of course.
Because the red blood cells are that crescent shape, they don't live as long and they don't carry oxygen very well.
A shortened red blood cell lifespan results in a cascade of events occurring in the body. Chronic anemia, severe pain, strokes, fatigue, decreased lung function, kidney function, heart function, and ultimately for the adults, a decreased lifespan. In the last decade, there's been explosion in the options to cure sickle cell disease. And the science is as elegant as it gets in human work. So you can take somebody's cell, fix that person's cell, put that cell back into that individual, and they're going to be cured of that disease. That is just a beautiful concept that we all dream about.
This is a completely new way of thinking about sickle cell, and engaging patients in these conversations is so important.
That discussion is not a four-hour discussion. That discussion is over years because it's experimental therapy and the information is evolving.
There's a role for this expensive, more scientifically amazing curative type therapies. But also we must focus on eliminating the disease burden in a broader population.
Within the US, there's 100,000 people living with sickle cell disease. Globally, there are around 20 to 30 million people living with sickle cell disease.
Sickle cell disease has sub-Saharan Africa as its epicenter, as well as the Middle East, India, and countries around the Mediterranean. Because of the high density of malaria, individuals who had sickle cell trait were protected from developing life-threatening malaria. And so as a result of evolutionary pressure, these are the regions that have the highest density of sickle cell disease. And then because of forced migration, enslavement, you have populations with sickle cell disease all over the world. The reality is the majority of children and adults with sickle cell disease do not get the level of care that they need, even in high-income countries. You can't identify a more strident example of health equity than how the healthcare system treats individuals with sickle cell disease. They are the canary in the coal mine for health equity.
When you get down to the lived patient experience of being in a hospital and essentially being triaged as though your pain is not real, that is a whole other condition into itself.
I have a PhD from Duke. I have to actually dress up in my Duke gear. Not that I could buy this at Walmart shirt, Duke gear, but that I know that somebody in the medical facility knows they must have got that on campus just to be treated like, you know, like I know what I'm talking about.
Racial disparities are a huge part of the conversation. I get the feeling I actually know we'd be further along if, you know, it wasn't a thing. Sickle cell is the oldest described molecular disorder. There have been disorders discovered after the fact that have more treatment options in terms of research and care.
For decades, there was no disease-modifying therapy. We were just watching individuals with sickle cell disease come to us with acute care needs. Over the last 20 years, a standard approach has been match-related donor myeloablative transplant. And the challenge has been that most adults cannot tolerate the toxicity associated with myeloablative chemotherapy, and you have to have a perfect match. And then in the mid-90s, there was a therapy referred to as hydroxyurea that was demonstrated to decrease the rate of pain, the life-threatening complication of the lung, and the rate of transfusions. This was a real breakthrough.
Hydroxyurea does many things, but essentially it raises your fetal hemoglobin. When the mother is pregnant, this is the type of hemoglobin that is used to carry oxygen throughout the body. After a baby is born, that fetal hemoglobin switches off and adult hemoglobin kicks in. And that's where sickle cell kicks in.
The induction of fetal hemoglobin by hydroxyurea interferes with the polymerization of sickle hemoglobin and therefore interferes with the cell shape change we see in the red blood cell to that sickle form. And as a result, downstream, the red blood cells live longer and the risks also go down.
The other part of the story and what's being researched today is increasing fetal hemoglobin through gene therapy.
Many are celebrating the earliest successes of gene therapy. It is certainly something that has given many families great hope. But it's always important to be sure that we are being transparent about what we know. Gene therapy is not without risk. It still requires that the patients undergo myeloablative chemotherapy to make space in the bone marrow for these corrected stem cells. Chemotherapy is associated with a number of complications, including a risk of cancer and infertility.
What I hear from adults is, I really don't want to be infertile. I really want a lot of children, but I don't want to die from this disease. And so it's a conversation about risk benefits, and I think it's incredibly personal.
There's a lot of excitement in the community at the potential of innovation and what it could mean, but there's also a concern. We definitely want to make sure we fully understand those risks and what the impacts may be for our lives beyond the treatment itself.
Things are changing within the landscape for the better. I firmly believe that we have to be able to provide multiple options for a disease that is so multifaceted. We need all these issues addressed in tandem with each other, right? So that nothing gets left behind.
When you have all the information that you need, you're able to think about what's best for you as an individual patient. I think that's the most important part.
The thing that keeps me going is my family and just who I am. I feel like I just always tell myself, like, don't let myself just completely fall down. Don't let myself just completely not make it.
We're not gonna do that. Individuals with sickle cell disease are whole people. I think now that, thanks to advances of science and the resilience of the community, now that we are surviving well into adulthood, we're realizing that survival is no longer enough.
We have to go the extra mile to make sure people understand, and that's just what it is. As long as people have all the information, then we can say we've done our job.